to our event to reclaim Armistice Day. I make also the coordinator of the Seven Brothers Brigade, Chapter 9 of Veterans Peace.
The catered event.
Armistice Day, also known as Veterans Day. But we want to reclaim it as Armistice Day, a day of peace, a day to mark the end of World War I on November 11th, 1918. So we've got a couple of speakers. Then we're going to ring the bells 11 times at 11:11, and then we've got some more speakers. And if anyone else wants to speak, just let me know. It's pretty open to anybody. So the first speaker is Pat Scanlon, who's a longtime activist, former coordinator of the chapter for years, and he's going to talk about Armistice Day.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. It's really nice that we're all here together. It's on Armistice Day. Today, at this exact hour, is the 105th anniversary of Armistice Day. On the 11th hour, the 11th day, the 11th month, November 11, 1918, the armistice between the Allies and Germany was signed, which ended hostilities on the Western Front, marking the end of World War to end all wars. Armistice Day was designated as a day to be dedicated to the cause of world peace and to be thereafter celebrated. In recognition of the significance of that date, in 1926, Congress resolved that this date should be commemorated with thanksgiving and prayer and exercises to perpetuate peace and through goodwill and mutual understanding between nations. Armistice Day was a hallowed anniversary because it was supposed to protect the future from future wars. Churches across Europe have celebrated peace by ringing their bells at this exact hour for the past 103 years. In 1954, President Dwight D. Eisenhower officially changed the name from Armistice Day to Veterans Day. By the stroke of his pen, a day dedicated to world peace was changed into a day that honors the military and militarism.
That's it.
Veterans Day is supposed to honor veterans from every war. A nice intention, but in reality, militarism becomes the central theme of the day, with all the pomp and ceremony glorifying the military establishment. The problem with that change made in 1954 is that the original intent and focus on world peace has been lost amongst the parades, 21-gun salutes, flyovers, and marching bands. Veterans for Peace has taken the lead among veterans organizations to reclaim the original intention of November 11th. As veterans, we know that a day that celebrates peace, not war, is the best way to honor sacrifices of veterans. On this Armistice Day, let us celebrate peace. On this day, November 11th, 2021, at 11:11, I stand with my veterans, brothers and sisters here on the Boston Common to commemorate Armistice Day and stand witness for world peace by ringing a bell at that exact moment. Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. Now we're going to have Dan Higgins read something called Litany of the Bells, which was written by a Veterans for Peace member, I believe. Yeah. And it's meant to be read either with bells or without. Tonight it's usually read with bells, but we're going to do the bells separately. So Dan is just going to read the Litany of the Bells. Dan Higgins.
Hearken the bells.
tolling to say, remember this day, those millions who died, their mourners who cried, cease warfare, cease. Peace, live in peace. Remember lives lost. Honor lives lost. Grieve for lives lost. Mourn.
You can take it off in here.
Our next speaker will be David Rothauser.
From the war of 1918 all the way to Afghanistan, beyond and before. Call me by my rightful name. I am Raytheon, Boeing, Lockheed Martin. No one can stop me. Thousands try. Oh, how they try. They stand outside my windows. Their lips curled in a surreal dance of words I cannot hear behind my soundproof, bulletproof windows. They send bushels of petitions to the Great White Father in the Great White House, urging, begging, demanding that I cease and desist. All the while, I feast on their names, their faceless names. The streets they live on, I devour ravenously, like the Goliath I so proudly am. They beg me to save the world's children, all the while turning a blind eye to the daily slaughter of their own. Their very own here in America. The daily barbecue of NRA guns, guns, guns. My brothers and sisters in the nuclear club share my legacy of nuclear mass destruction from Chernobyl to Three Mile Island to Bikini Atoll to the Arctic Ocean. But only I own Hiroshima and Nagasaki. No one can touch me to the tune of hundreds of thousands of lives taken by radiation poisoning. I'm insatiable. I stand alone. I know no flag. No God, no moral. You voted to protect me. You voted federal laws to protect me. I'm the only business in America immunized from liability when crimes are committed using my weapons of mass destruction. My weapons are your national security. My weapons are your wealth to the moon and Mars. My weapons make jobs for the hungry in America. My weapons make humanitarian aid. You protect me. You make me feel good about who I am. I am the source of America's wars. I throw down the gauntlet. I welcome you. My portals are open. Step inside. Track me down. See me face to face. Talk to me. Break the source if you dare. Repeal the laws you created to protect me. Repeal the federal laws you created to protect me. Repeal them. The choice is yours, if you dare. You know my name. I'm Raytheon, Boeing, Lockheed Martin. I am the source of America's wars. All of them. All the way to Afghanistan, beyond and before.
That was pretty powerful. I hate going after that. But I want to talk about Smedley Butler, who our chapter is named for. Smedley Butler was the most decorated Marine in history. He's taught in boot camp of the Marines for his medals. But in fact, he won 2 medals of honor and the Brevet Medal, and was the only Marine to have done so. Except, what they don't teach about Smedley Butler is that in the 1930s, he turned against war. He turned against everything that he had done before and spoke about it. He spoke to audiences all over the country. So I'd like to read some of the quotes from his books and from his speeches. War is a racket. It always has been. It is possibly the oldest, easily the most profitable, surely the most vicious. It is the only one international in scope. It is the only one in which the profits are reckoned in dollars and the losses in lives. A racket is best described, I believe, as something that is not what it seems to the majority of the people. Only a small inside group knows what it is about. It is conducted for the benefit of the few at the expense of the very many. Out of war, a few people make huge fortunes. There are only 2 reasons why you should ever be asked to give your youngsters. One is for the defense of our homes. The other is the defense of our Bill of Rights, and particularly the right to worship God as we see fit. Every other reason advanced for the murder of young men is a racket. Pure and simple. The normal profits of a business concern in the United States are 6, 8, 10, and sometimes 12%. But wartime profits, that is another matter. 20, 60, 100, 300, and even 1800%. The sky is the limit. All that traffic will bear. Uncle Sam has the money. Let's get it. I spent 33 years and 4 months in active military service. And during that that period, I spent most of my time as a high-class muscle man for big business, for Wall Street and the bankers. In short, I was a racketeer, a gangster for capitalism. I helped make Mexico and especially Tampico safe for American oil interests in 1914. I helped make Haiti and Cuba a decent place for the National City Bank boys to collect revenues in. I helped in the raping of half a dozen Central American republics for the benefit of Wall Street. I helped purify Nicaragua for the international banking house of Brown Brothers in 1902-12. I brought light to the Dominican Republic for the American sugar interests in 1916. I helped make Honduras right for the American fruit companies in 1903. In China in 1927, I helped see to it that Standard Oil went on its way unmolested. Looking back on it, I might have given Al Capone a few hints. The best he could do was operate his racket in three districts. I operated on three continents. Thank you. The next speaker is Joe Cabardis, who will read something that one of our members sent in who could not make it today, written by Joe Hill.
Thank you very much for being here. It's wonderful to be here at Armistice Day, and I want to thank the Veterans for Peace for letting me speak. And this is an important day in our lives. We should dedicate ourselves and rededicate ourselves to working for peace. This is the 20th Armistice Day we've been in the war of terror. Middle East. It's just so hard to believe that people say after the Afghanistan debacle that the war is over. It is still going on with soldiers in harm's way in Iraq and Syria. So we have to still work for peace. We have to cut this military budget. Okay, Joe Hill, written by Joe Hill. This is a poem. 1915. A little girl with her father stayed in a cabin across the sea. Her mother dear in the cold gray clay. With her father, she'd always be. But then one day the great war broke out and the father was told to go. The little girl pleaded her father she needed. She begged, cried, and pleaded so. Don't take my papa away from me. Don't leave me here all alone. He has cared for me so tenderly ever since mother has gone. Nobody ever like him can be. No one can so with me play. Don't take my papa away from me. Please don't take my papa away. Her tender pleading. Her pleadings were all in vain, and her father went to the war. He'll never kiss her goodnight again, for he fell amid the cannon's roar. Greater a soldier was never born, but his brave heart was pierced one day, and as he was dying, he heard someone cry, a little girl's voice from far away. Don't take my papa away from me. Don't leave me there all alone. He was cared for me so tenderly ever since mother was gone. Nobody ever liked him can be. No one can so with me play. Don't take my papa away. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. Next up is Ray Ajimian.
It's my opinion that World War I was a defining event of the 20th century. You think about it, communism may not have happened, Hitler may not have happened, etc. except for World War One. In World War One, simply did not have to happen. Can you hear me now?
No, no, sir.
There were 5 weeks between. There were 5 weeks between the assassination of the Archduke and the beginning of World War One. During that time, there was plenty of opportunities for the nations to simply pull back from war, and they did not. In the end, 40 million casualties occurred because of World War One. I want to give you one spotlight, one example of the futility of war. This is Armistice Day. Armistice Day, November 11th, at 11 o'clock. But a lot of people don't realize the armistice was signed at 5 a.m. It was not to take effect until 11 a.m. The question is, what do armies do between 5 a.m. and 11 a.m.? General Pershing, the commander of the American forces, wanted to go all the way to Berlin. He was against the armistice. So he simply told his subordinate officers that the armistice would take effect at 11 a.m. But he gave no orders. Thus, the general of the American army decided to do what they want on their own. And some of them ordered their troops into battle. I want to read one example. At 16 minutes before 11, a runner caught up with the 313th Paris 157th Brigade to report that the armistice has been signed. Again, the message made no mention of what to do in the interim. Brigadier General William Nicholson, commanding the brigade, made his decision. There will be absolutely no let-up until 11 a.m. More runners were dispatched to spread the word to the farthest advanced regiments, including Gunther. He's one of the men. The 313th now gathered below a ridge called Côte Roman. Two German machine gun squadrons manned a roadblock watch, disbelieving as shapes began emerging from the fog. Gunther and Sergeant Powell dropped to the ground and bullets sang above their heads. The Germans then ceased firing, assuming that the Americans would have the good sense to stop with the end so near. Suddenly, Powell saw Gunther rise and begin loping towards the machine guns. He shouted for Gunther to stop. Machine gunners waved him back, but Gunther kept advancing. The enemy reluctantly fired a fired round burst. Gunther was struck in the left temple and died instantly. The time was 10:59 a.m. General Pershing's order of the day would later record Henry Gunther as the last American killed in war. After the fact, believe it or not, Congress did hold hearings on this 5 a.m. to 11 a.m. And Pershing and some of the generals were brought before the committee to explain themselves. One small exchange from a representative. How many generals did you lose that day? Blaine went on. None, General Foner replied. How many colonels did you lose that day? Foner, I do not know how many you lost. How many lieutenant colonels did you lose that day? Connor, I do not know the teals of any of them. I'm convinced, Bland, as the representative continued, that on November 11th, there was not any officer of very high rank taking any chance of losing his own life. Connor, visibly seething, retorted, the statement made by you, I think, Mr. Bland, is exceedingly unjust, and as an officer who was over there, I resent it to the highest possible degree. Bland shot back. I resent the fact that these lives were lost, and the American people resent the fact that these lives were lost. But we have a right to question the motive, if necessary, of the men who were patient or faith in this loss of life. With that, Connor was dismissed. And of course, after the hearings were finished, nothing was done. Thank you.
Next up is Webb Nichols.
My name is Webb Nichols.
I am a Vietnam veteran. With your forbearance, I would like to read something that I wrote for this day. But before I do that, I'd like to say we all have our own reality. And when I'm here among this group,
There are people among us who every day work for peace. That is not me. I want to be clear about that. I appreciate everybody being here because your motivations and your inclinations are inspiring. Requiem for a veteran. A dying veteran makes their last sacrifice. A living veteran endures the reality of war. Never praise it, never wish it, never be it. Veterans Day, Armistice Day, Remembrance Day, marked on the 11th hour, the 11th day, the 11th month of each year. First recorded at Compiègne, France in 1918, at the end of World War I. Down through the ages, praise and despair, flowers and monuments, red poppies and centopaths, on this day the living have revisited bravery and death, seldom the slaughter and remorse, leaving fathers and sons, mothers and daughters, wives and friends. Terrible silence of the abyss of loss and their suffering.
Was there ever truly a
just war?
Was there ever truly a moral imperative? For the wars fought in our name, the times are changing.
What's that? The art of war is now a cynical techno enterprise, and with its suffering, it is hard to see bravery. It is hard and even harder to see victory. If there ever is one, when there are none. Veterans Day, homage to the men and women whose beliefs exceeded their fears. In honoring their desires and wishes of others, often less loyal, less noble, we must surrender to this reality and continue to fight for peace. Thank you.
Next up is Peter Castle. Good morning. That sounds better. I have a short poem that I'm going to read. Fortunately, it's short. We've heard a number of wonderful, eloquent thoughts. Mine are somewhat lower, but I wrote the poem because I couldn't find any poem that seemed suitable for me, at least. So here we go with the poem. The title is Poem Against War. War wastes, destroys, and kills, manufactures hatred and bills. Its false glory is a sham, glamorized by moneyed scams. On every Veterans Day, I would add. Why then does it never end? Because foolish power always transcends. Peace is the sweet prospect that we need, always the bomb ahead, our finest deed. Thank you. Is Alan Fujita here? Alan? I guess not. Okay. Our last speaker is Jeff Parenti, member of the Smedley Butler Brigade, and I have no idea what he's going to talk on, but I'm sure it'll be good.
Okay. So I have a little piece that I wrote. It's called Thank You for Your Service. Thank you for your service, but I'm late to my second job. Thank you for your service. Hey, did you see Squid Game? Thank you for your service, but I have to go find somewhere to sleep tonight. Thank you for your service. Hey, I just saw this great article on Facebook. Thank you for your service. Does this water taste funny to you? Thank you for your service. Here's your free burger. Thank you for your service, but we're denying your disability claim. Thank you for your service. Do you have a couple of bucks so I can get a sandwich? Thank you for your service. Can you share this GoFundMe for my surgery? Thank you for your service. Aren't China and Russia scary? So I wrote this piece because it's something that is said a lot nowadays. Thank you for your service. And it's said with the best of intentions, but a lot of the times that tends to be all that's said, and there's not much reflection on what goes on behind that. And so this was written to highlight some of the distractions that cause us on a daily basis to ignore the fact that we're still in Iraq and Syria, that we just got out of Afghanistan with nothing to show for it. We've spent trillions of dollars, and we could have spent it on universal health care, on clean drinking water for places like Flint, Michigan. And we could have spent it to help get rid of homelessness and food insecurity. So that's what it's about, to highlight what we could have done with the money instead of spending it on these wars, and how we distract ourselves to forget that fact.
Thanks. That was powerful. Thanks, Jeff. And that's pretty much the end of our program. Keep on working for peace every day. And, you know, hopefully we can end the military-industrial complex that's now spending 700... Oh, okay. John, you want to speak? Okay. Does anybody else want to speak before we end? John, you want to speak?
The standing joke among us old-time Spedleys is thank you for your service, as opposed to being labeled as a baby-killing rape killer. The image changed when they did away with the draft. But as a young silver bar in 63 sent to Vietnam by JFK's commandant, who was, by the way, a big fan of Smedley, General Shute, to write up the fact that, you know, Vietnam was exactly what General Shute was warning us about a good 25 years ago. So anyway, we wrote it up. November 63, they killed the president. General Shute was promptly fired by Johnson as not a team player. We were off and running. So I knew that day that Smedley was right then and right now. And if war is a racket, do you think that a criminal enterprise might be afoot? And I thought, and I said, it has to be a self-legalized criminal enterprise, DBA, the U.S. government. And who owns the government? You know, need I say further, war is a racket. The people are rulers who own the banks, who control the governments and the media, finance both sides for profit, but parenthetically, their kids serve the country by going to law school. And you don't happen to have a deed of ownership of a place when you own the place's lawmakers, do you? My two cents.
Anybody else want to say anything?
1999. I have survivor guilt. I lost 20 buddies in I was ordained as a minister when I was a teenager. The saddest one, McGeary Littlejohn, Bob Hope's special, had shrapnel with his leg elevated. He got gangrene and died. I dedicated my whole life as a peace activist to someday start a business based on my mother's philosophy, economic justice, peace. Injustice, war. 2002, I spoke at Harvard. 450 international developers. Globalization after September 11th, has anything changed? The tragedy, greed run amok. Cars are better built, but there's no middle class. I told them my spiritual mother said the world's problems are spiritual, not racial or economic. 20 years later, to God be the glory, I'm raising hundreds of millions of Jewish money in Brookline, here in Boston, to prototype an international business system competing with Amazon, consumer goods, durable goods, Mercedes, where rich people sell Mercedes for poor people. I didn't say Mercedes at Kennedy School because they have the mafia put a bullet in. My advisor said, whisper on the cheek, Ernie Barr will only do repairs. Multi-level every city on earth where Palestinians will sponsor Jews to deliver. We're going public next year. God be the glory and peace in the Middle East.
What's your name?
I've been anonymous. My advisor, 99, says, stay homeless for 20 years, whatever it takes. Who would expect a homeless man be thinking as a revolutionary. Dennis Jackson, I'm coming out of the closet. Thank you, Dennis. Thank you, Dennis.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for coming. And please keep on working for peace in the world.